Hello, everyone. I'm Ron Waxman from the MedStar Washington Hospital Center. We are having a special series on COVID-19. And today we have with us Dr. Ben Kenzberg, who is an attending cardiologist and intensivist at the MedStar Washington Hospital Center. And he actually just presented a week ago a great overview on the COVID-19. And I asked him to come and present it to us as well. Welcome, Ben.
Thank you for having me, Dr. Waxman. So I'm going to be going through COVID-19 specifically targeted towards cardiologists in the community and people interested in cardiovascular disease. This talk was presented on April 14th, 2020, and the case number and incidence numbers are accurate up until that point. So what you see here is the dashboard from the Johns Hopkins website on the global burden of COVID-19. And as of April 13th in the evening, there were 1.9 million cases across the world, including almost 120,000 deaths. More locally, there were 580,000 cases across the United States. Looking at the US more specifically, you'll see that the case burden is localized really more to the coasts and to the urban areas, some of the cities in the more of the Midwest, but the biggest burden of disease has certainly been in the New York City area. Across the United States there, as I said, there are about 10,000 deaths. Looking here at Washington, D.C. more locally, you can see that as of April 13th in the evening, there are almost 2,000 cases, including 52 deaths. And what you'll see also is that there's been an increase in testing over the last 2 weeks specifically, up to 10,000, almost 11,000 people tested in this city over that time frame. And that's really reflects a local increase in testing capacity. Most locally here at Washington Hospital Center, we have, at least as of April 14th, we have 142 cases with about 40 in the ICU. Most of those are intubated patients. In terms of projections, it's very hard, and there's a lot of different conflicting different projection metrics. This one from the University of Washington suggests that peak resource use occurred on April 9th, although we continue to see an increase over time. And so this has really become an area of great challenge and great importance. And I think every area is seeing this projection fluctuate based on local case changes. A couple definition points which are important. The virus itself is referred to as the severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2, or SARS-CoV-2, also known as the 2019 novel coronavirus. The disease, however, is referred to as coronavirus disease 2019, or COVID-19. I will try to keep this talk focused on evidence-based medicine. This is a challenge with COVID-19, given that the disease is so new and there is an unfortunate paucity in high quality scientific evidence for the disease. Just on a PubMed search looking at COVID-19 and coronavirus, there have been over 4,000 articles on this disease in PubMed since December 2019. Very little of it is high quality data. Most of it is anecdotal and observational, but we'll go through the data that is the most clinically relevant. Starting with pathophysiology, the functional receptor for SARS-CoV-2 is the ACE2 receptor. And this is a receptor which is familiar to everyone who focuses on cardiovascular disease. This is the same ACE2 receptor that is part of the renin-angiotensin-aldosterone cascade. ACE2 is highly expressed in the lung and in the heart, and is a key counter-regulatory enzyme that degrades angiotensin 2 to angiotensin and attenuates its effects on vasoconstriction, sodium retention, and fibrosis. Keep these things in mind as we move forward in the discussion, as this does have implications for pathophysiology and potentially therapeutic interventions. In terms of the COVID-19 pathophysiology, looking at the lungs, which are sort of most notably an organ that's affected by this disease state, pulmonary manifestations of this disease based on some limited autopsy series demonstrate diffuse alveolar damage, airway inflammation, and viral cytopathic-like changes that are localized to the pulmonary interstitium. These are all potentially typical findings that can be seen with a viral pneumonitis. The hematological manifestations are also important, and again, based on a retrospective cohort series, some autopsy series, and these manifestations include DIC, or disseminated intravascular coagulation, diffuse thrombosis, which has been noted as both venous thromboembolic disease, which has been seen up to 25 or 30% of patients in some cohort series, an elevated D-dimer level, and pulmonary congestion with microvascular thrombosis and occlusion, which is also notable, and we'll come back to that later, both for progression of pathophysiology and for an area of possible therapeutic intervention. And then finally, in this disease state, the cytokine storm or systemic inflammation is likely critical to the disease progression in certain individuals. And I think it's really well summarized in this article in Press in JHLT, which identifies three stages to this disease state. In stage one, you have early infection with a viral response phase, which is really manifested as mild constitutional symptoms, a low-grade fever, dry cough, diarrhea, headache. These are sort of the early symptoms of this disease state. Stage two, or the pulmonary phase, is identified by shortness of breath and hypoxia with abnormal chest imaging. Stage three, the hyperinflammatory phase, is largely due to the host inflammatory response and not the virus directly. And in this stage, the clinical symptoms are predominantly severe organ failure, surge, shock, ARDS, and cardiac failure. And clinically can be identified by very elevated inflammatory markers as well as end organ failure. These different stages of the disease, although at this point still relatively hypothetical, do also has potential implications for therapies, including how to deal with immunosuppression and immunomodulation in this disease state. And one other thing just about timing, which we'll go over later, is that the progression through these stages can be on the order of a week, although we'll go into more depth in a little bit. This cytokine storm has manifestations on the cardiovascular system. As we know, any inflammatory state can increase your risk for myocardial infarction, for heart failure exacerbation, and for arrhythmias, both atrial and ventricular. So how do we make the diagnosis of COVID-19? Largely, it's based on pretest probability, and that's because there is no perfect gold standard test with 100% sensitivity. So your pretest probability really depends on symptoms. That includes things like cough, fever, shortness of breath, hypoxemia. In particular, cough is the most dominant symptom. Fever is maybe only present in about 50% of people at the time of presentation and initial diagnosis. There are also some other interesting clinical findings and clinical symptoms of this disease. That includes loss of smell and GI symptoms, including nausea, abdominal discomfort, diarrhea, that can be the initial manifestations of COVID-19. Based on your pre-test probability, the next test that is sent is your PCR. And the PCR sensitivity on average is only about 80%, although this is really based on expert opinion and several cohort studies. So that 80% sensitivity does not adequately rule out COVID-19 in people with a high pretest probability. And I think that point is very important. The PCR sampling errors can be due to diagnostic, it can create a diagnostic dilemma, and that can be due to dynamic conversion from negative to positive. It can be due to sampling error. But the net result of that is that a single negative PCR does not exclude COVID-19, and that's especially true if it's obtained from a nasopharyngeal source or if it was taken relatively early in the disease course. And some publications have noted that lower respiratory tract samples from a protected tracheal aspirate, for example, as opposed to a nasopharyngeal swab, are more likely to be positive than the upper respiratory tract samples. And that's something we should keep in mind as we interpret these test results. Some other publications, specifically out of China, have talked about CT chest as a diagnostic parameter for COVID-19. And in these cohorts, which were in populations with a high prevalence of disease and without good access at that point to adequate PCR testing, the CT chest sensitivity was 97%. And I think we can think about this as ruling out at least that stage two, that pulmonary phase of disease. If a CT chest does not show any findings that are consistent with viral inflammation, bilateral ground glass, anything that's consistent with atypical pneumonia, then the disease is likely not present in that, at least in that stage. However, these radiographic findings are nonspecific and don't necessarily rule in the disease state. It really depends on clinical context as well. In terms of biomarkers, unfortunately, and this publication from Annals just last week, I think had a good quote about this, but unfortunately there are no biomarkers or combination of biomarkers that currently exist that are sensitive or specific enough to establish a diagnosis of COVID-19. This is certainly a dynamic area, and this may change over time, but as of now, biomarkers may be prognostic, and we'll talk about that, but not that helpful from a diagnostic standpoint. And finally, serology or antibody tests are an area that are undergoing active research. At this time, they're not directly clinically used across the country, and certainly not from a diagnostic standpoint, but that will likely change over time. So in terms of the prognosis, and this data comes from one of the largest cohorts that was published. This came from the Chinese Center for Disease Control and Prevention. This is a cohort of 44,000 patients with COVID-19. And what you can see here is that the vast majority of patients were between the ages of 30 and 79. Importantly, there was a spectrum of disease that really skews towards mild. The large majority of cases, 81%, were mild. And that's defined as not needing supplemental oxygen therapy. These patients often had very symptomatic disease with a headache or abdominal symptoms, but did not require supplemental oxygen. 14% of people had severe disease. And in this case, severe disease was defined as requiring supplemental oxygen. And then 5% of patients had critical disease, which was defined as multi-organ failure, requiring mechanical ventilation, septic shock states, anything that really identifies a really sick cohort in the intensive care unit setting. In terms of case fatality rate, in this cohort, about 2% of patients died. This was a much greater percentage, 15% in people that were over the age of 80, 8% in people over the age of 70 to 79. And so there's clearly an age association with death. In addition to that, critical cases had a 49% mortality rate. Again, a much higher association with death than the overall population. In terms of healthcare workers in of themselves, in this cohort, 4% of the total population were healthcare workers. The vast majority of those were in, or the majority of those were from Wuhan directly. 15% of these cases were classified as severe or critical. So a higher percentage than the overall population, which may reflect some of the viral pathophysiology being due to initial dose of exposure. In this cohort, there were 5 deaths. There are significant fluctuations in case fatality rate. This, for example, comes from the same Johns Hopkins website, their dashboard. And what you can see, just highlighting 2 countries in Europe. In Germany, the case fatality ratio was about 2.5%, while in Italy, the case fatality ratio was 12.8%. And this likely reflects how an individual healthcare system may be able to handle the overall burden of disease, especially when hospitals are largely overrun with COVID-19. It may also reflect variations in the local population. The Italian population at the time of this talk, is being interpreted as having been older than some of the other national data that was reported. But regardless, it reflects that there can be a wide fluctuation in case fatality ratio across different parts of the world. So how to think about prevalence of this disease, and really talking about asymptomatic disease. Unfortunately, it's a little hard to give a meaningful answer to that, as there has not been broad pan-societal testing that's been done. 2 cohorts that were particularly informative, though, are the obstetric patients at Columbia New Presbyterian and the Diamond Princess cruise ship. At one point, the Diamond Princess cruise ship actually had the largest cluster of COVID-19 cases outside of China, and broad testing was done in this patient population. on the cruise ship at one point, they had diagnosed 634 PCR positive COVID-19 cases. Amongst these individuals, 18% were completely asymptomatic at the time of testing. The Columbia New York Presbyterian obstetric patients included 215 consecutive pregnant women who were admitted to these institutions in New York City. Among these patients, 13.5% were completely asymptomatic at the time of testing. And to me, I think that that really highlights a couple of key points. One is that there is a percentage of your population that is asymptomatic, and that is important to keep in mind as we continue to think that these patients are capable of spreading the virus and may have similar viral burdens as symptomatic patients. But also, at least looking at this cohort from this obstetric cohort, you can see here that the percentage of patients who are asymptomatic is almost six times greater than the percentage of patients who are symptomatic. So the overall societal burden of disease may be much higher than we think it is, just focusing on testing in symptomatic individuals. However, this is certainly an area of ongoing research. One thing about the Diamond Princess cohort is that a subset of these patients did get chest CTs, and in a retrospective analysis of that, of those 104 patients, of whom 73% were asymptomatic, there's a key distinction between the symptomatic and asymptomatic patients. Amongst the asymptomatic patients, 54% were noted to have lung opacities at the time of this analysis, and 80% who were symptomatic had lung opacities. But again, you can see that lung opacities are present in both cohorts, in both groups of people, regardless of symptoms. Looking into the clinical course itself, so after exposure, an incubation period can range up to 2 to 7 days, although it may average around 4 days, and these are sort of rough estimates. The beginning of dyspnea can occur about 6 days after exposure. Hospital admission occurs approximately 8 days after exposure, and ICU admission and intubation occurs about 10 days post-exposure. So again, the time frame from initial exposure to the disease to ICU hospitalization and intubation is can be a week and a half or longer. Again, looking at talking about prognosis, we'll talk about risk factors, and that includes risk factors, and these are really for mortality, and that comes from a range of different cohorts that includes Chinese cohorts out of Hubei province and Wuhan, cohorts from Seattle, cohorts from Italy. And these cohorts do have some overlap and similarity in their risk factors that are identified, and there are some that are different. But putting together the overall implications of these different cohorts, we can see that risk factors for mortality include older age, as was previously mentioned, male sex, critical illness, and importantly, having a history of chronic hypertension or comorbid cardiovascular disease is also associated with an increased risk for mortality. Biomarkers that are predictive of mortality, although again, these are not perfect cohort studies, and these may be confounded by other comorbidities, but these biomarkers, at least what we can tell, do predict mortality, and that includes things like absolute lymphopenia, having elevated LFTs or creatinine, elevated LDH, elevated cardiac biomarkers, including troponin and an NT-BNP, hematological marker, D-dimer, and then many different types of inflammatory markers, all associated with mortality. And then finally, disease severity. So as was previously identified, critical illness is associated with much higher incidence of mortality. And so things that go along with critical illness, including ARDS, sepsis, acute cardiac injury, and acute kidney injury, are all potentially prognostic for mortality. Diving into that a little bit further, here's some data, more data about age, and this comes from Italian and compared to Chinese literature. And what we can see in the Italian literature is that the mortality rate for the oldest cohort here, the age greater than 80, is about 20% in this cohort, 13% in those over the age of 70, 3.5% in those over the age of 60, 60 to 69, but 1% or less in people below the age of 60. In the Chinese cohort here, we can see a similar trend towards increased mortality based on age. Looking at having a history of cardiovascular comorbidities, what we can see here from this Chinese data is that on the under pie chart A, the confirmed COVID-19 cases, we can see that amongst this group of individuals, of 15,000 individuals, the majority of them had a history of chronic respiratory disease. Only 13% had a history of hypertension, 4% had a history of cardiovascular disease, 5% had a history of diabetes. However, looking at this same group, but more specifically the subgroup who died, the confirmed COVID-19 deaths, you can see there's a much greater percentage, a much greater saturation of hypertension in this group, 32%, cardiovascular disease, 18%, and diabetes, 16%. So people with these comorbidities, it seemed to be associated with a greater risk of death in this group, in this data at least. This is also suggested by American data. So here we can see, this is data comes from, was published in MMWR and represents a population of 74,000 people from the American data. And what we can see here is that having any comorbidities, having at least one or more conditions, so that's this the bottom line here, only 27% of the overall not hospitalized cohort met that criteria. However, you're looking at the hospitalized non-ICU patients, 71% of those patients had at least one or more comorbidities, and in the ICU admission cohort here, 78% of them had at least one or more comorbidities. So the, you know, the underlying presence of comorbidities is associated with progressive illness and potentially mortality. Looking at critical illness in and of itself, here we have 344 intensive care treated COVID-19 Chinese patients. The mortality in this group at 28 days was 40%, 39%, and the median survival here was 25 days. And that's meaningful because the duration of critical illness can be quite long. The duration of time requiring mechanical ventilation can be 2 to 3 weeks. In this cohort, amongst the people who received invasive ventilation, there was a 97% mortality at 28 days, which may not be as high, which may be higher than has been demonstrated in other cohorts, but at least in this group of patients, it was associated with a very high incidence of mortality. Amongst the group that received high flow nasal cannula only, there was a 58% mortality at 28 days. Looking at the population of people here who had ARDS, so 100 out of those patients, 100 of those patients out of 145 who had ARDS required invasive mechanical ventilation, which was 69%. Looking at the biomarkers, specifically troponin, and this data also comes from a cohort in China. And what we can see here is that an elevated troponin above the upper limit of normal was seen in 20% of patients who were diagnosed with COVID-19. And having an elevated troponin was associated with a higher incidence of a whole different host of complications, including mortality in 51% of these patients, as opposed to 4.5% of those who did not have an elevated troponin. ARDS, 58 versus 15%, AKI, acute kidney injury in about 9% versus 0.3%, receiving non-invasive mechanical ventilation in 46% versus 3.9%, and in receiving invasive mechanical ventilation in 22% versus 4.2%. So again, in this cohort, having an elevated troponin was significantly associated with a higher incidence of complications. And here we see some graphics from that same data that demonstrate this early and ongoing split between these two groups regarding survival, both in terms of time from symptom onset and time from admission to a hospital. In a different group of patients, still looking at troponin, here we have an incidence of elevated troponin of 28% in this cohort. Interestingly, if you looked at the people with a history of cardiovascular disease versus those without a history of cardiovascular disease, 54% of those with a history of cardiovascular disease had an elevated troponin, as opposed to only 13% in those without any known cardiovascular disease history. And this this paper breaks down this data into quadrants. So a cohort of patients without known cardiovascular disease with a normal troponin, people with a history of cardiovascular disease with a normal troponin, people without cardiovascular disease and an elevated troponin, And finally, people with a history of cardiovascular disease and elevated troponin. And you can see here in this graphic that there is a significant difference in mortality between these different groups of individuals, with by far the highest mortality in those with a history of cardiovascular disease and an elevated troponin. In this paper, that was associated with a 69% mortality, as opposed to 7.6% in the lowest risk group, those without known cardiovascular disease and with a normal troponin. So moving forward to D-dimer, this comes from retrospective cohort data as well. And D-dimer, there's been a few different papers looking at it. One paper that identified that on admission, having a D-dimer that is greater than 1 microgram per milliliter had an odds ratio for in-hospital mortality of 18% of 18, which is significantly elevated. Other papers have identified a high incidence of venous thromboembolic disease in this patient population, and that in cohorts has ranged from 25 to 30% of people. And a D-dimer greater than 1.5 micrograms per milliliter in one paper, in one cohort, had a sensitivity of 85%, a specificity of almost 89%, and a negative predictive value of almost 95% for diagnosing venous thromboembolic disease. That's DVT and pulmonary embolism. So moving on from predictive markers, but into treatment. And I'll just start by saying that there really is no definitive therapy. The Infectious Disease Society of America guidelines that came out last week state that there are no definitive treatments for this disease, unfortunately, and that the only therapies that are recommended should be given as part of clinical trials. So at this point, the only treatments that we can offer these patients is really supportive care, and most specifically, supplemental oxygenation and mechanical ventilation when required. However, looking at some of the therapies that are under investigation, that includes antiviral medications, including lopinavir, ritonavir, antibiotic and immunomodulating medications, including hydroxychloroquine, remdesivir, medications targeted towards the host inflammatory response, including tocilizumab, medications targeting the cardiovascular enzyme and hormonal axis, including ARBs and ACE inhibitors. Again, keeping in mind the receptor for viral entry. There's also data looking at convalescent plasma therapy, potentially TPA and systemic anticoagulation, and hyperbaric oxygen, among many, many others. And I'll go through some of the ones that have data behind them or potential to yield clinically useful results. First and most importantly, talking about mechanical ventilation, and this is an area of active and ongoing research. This data comes from Dr. Gattinoni, which comes from the Italian literature. And here what we see are two different patients. On patient A on the top, has lungs that look relatively normal radiographically with some areas of ground glass opacification. On CT, the aerated lung is black. Patient B on the bottom has lungs that are heavily diseased with dense consolidation and lots of ground glass opacifications. If you label these parts of the lung as blue or aerated lung versus red or consolidated lung, you can see there's a striking difference between these two patients based on these charts on the right. However, both of these patients have severely reduced P to F ratios, which is a marker of your arterial oxygenation relative to the delivery of oxygen to that particular individual patient. So the hypoxia we see in these patients is not necessarily directly correlated with the severity of lung injury. And why is that? What does that mean? Well, this same group of authors has attempted to explain that by identifying two different phenotypes of lung disease. There is phenotype L versus phenotype H. Now, phenotype H is the more potentially traditional ARDS-like form of pulmonary edema and lung collapse. It's associated with high lung elastance or low lung compliance, high recruitability, high right to left shunting of blood, and a higher response to PEEP. On the other side, phenotype L, which is the lung we saw that looked more black on CT scan, is a lung that is really a dysregulation of pulmonary perfusion as opposed to lung consolidation. These patients have low elastins or high compliance, a low VQ mismatch, low recruitability, and limited PEEP response. And so these two patient populations are distinct. How one gets from phenotype L to phenotype H, because that seems to be what we see. These are not phenotypes that are throughout the whole course of the hospitalization, but somebody in phenotype L might move into phenotype H physiology. And that's not entirely known at this point. One of the areas that's being proposed are these pulmonary microthrombi leading to progressive lung disease. Another is ventilator-induced lung injury or aerotrauma due to these prolonged courses of ventilation. At this time, this is still an area of ongoing research. However, overall, treating these patients with evidence-based ARDS treatment to avoid barotrauma is certainly recommended in all patients. Lopinavir-ritonavir, this has been studied and has in a randomized controlled trial from China in which hospitalized adult patients who had confirmed SARS-CoV-2 infection and were hypoxic with an oxygen saturation of 94% or less on room air were randomized to lopinavir-ritonavir versus control. And as you can see here, there was no significant difference in cumulative improvement rate in this trial, which is the primary outcome, or viral load, at least in this particular cohort. There were about 100 patients in each arm. Hydroxychloroquine, azithromycin, there have been previous unpublished trials in China that suggested efficacy for chloroquine. This paper, launched some of the early focus on this as a potentially effective therapy for COVID-19, I think is worth going through in a little bit more depth. So this trial from France, or this data from France, is a non-randomized observational cohort of total of only 42 patients. 26 of these patients were treated with hydroxychloroquine. 16 untreated patients were used as controls. They came from another center or had refused the protocol. Only 20 of the treated patients actually completed the study. Six of those received azithromycin as well. Again, this is observational data. None of these patients were assigned to therapy. Of the patients who didn't complete the protocol, three of those patients were transferred to the intensive care unit, presumably because they got sicker, and one patient died. The other two patients were either nauseous or stopped the medication for other reasons. And I think that this is important background knowledge to have, because the primary outcome that the authors reported, which was percentage of patients with PCR positive samples over time, over serial PCR assessments, at least visually suggests that the combination of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin leads to a significant reduction in the number of PCR positive samples, that hydroxychloroquine alone also is associated with a reduction in PCR positive samples compared to control. However, keep in mind that there's only six patients total in the hydroxychloroquine azithromycin group, and there were, for example, six patients who did not have their data reported. And it would be quite easy to have even small changes in the data significantly affect their overall outcomes. At best, I would say that this is hypothesis generating data. The ISAC, the society that publishes the journal that this data was published in, actually after it came out with a statement that said the article does not meet the society's expected standard. And at this point, at least, there has been one follow-up paper by a different group, also from France, of 11 patients who received the same treatment protocol that was used in the previous publication. And this group did not demonstrate any significant improvement in viral clearance in their patient cohort. So, I would hope that this therapy or any therapy that is appropriately studied demonstrates efficacy. At this time, there's really not enough data to say that this is an effective treatment for this disease state. Remdesivir is a nucleotide analog prodrug that inhibits the viral RNA polymerase. This data, which was published in New England Journal of Medicine on April 10th, represents the compassionate use of remdesivir for patients with severe COVID-19. This was a compassionate use trial. There is no placebo arm. And their primary outcome was change in amount of oxygen support. And so at the top is the category on an ordinal scale from invasive disease to ambient air. And then going down below that, you'll see the number of patients in each oxygen support group after treatment. And the takeaways of this data from my standpoint are that 57% of patients who are on mechanical ventilation at the time of enrollment were ultimately extubated, and three of the four patients who were on ECMO had ECMO decannulated successfully. That is, again, hypothesis generating data, and certainly better than some historical retrospective cohort data in critical illness. However, again, this is really just hypothesis generating. There was no control group. There was potentially cherry picking of patients. Again, only 61 total patients out of potentially thousands that applied for the compassionate use of the drug. There was relatively undefined inclusion criteria, a saturation less than 94% on room air. It did include some patients that were potentially relatively minimally ill. There was also loss of patients to follow up. Seven of the 61 initially enrolled patients were excluded due to no post day one clinical data. There was no real primary endpoint. There was minimal baseline patient data. And potentially importantly, from a pathophysiological standpoint, the drug was delivered at a median of 12 days after symptom onset. Again, so it's hard, I would say it's really hard to extrapolate out of this trial much, except for the fact that it is hypothesis generating. And we certainly look forward to future data that more emphatically demonstrates the efficacy of this drug. Although at this time, the data remains incomplete. Looking at ACE inhibitors and ARBs, the current recommendation across a spectrum of cardiovascular societies is to continue your RAS inhibition in people that have an indication for an ACE inhibitor and ARB. There are clinical trials that are underway looking at this pathway, and that includes trials looking at prophylactically changing antihypertensive medications from RAS inhibition to other medications, trials looking at ARBs as a COVID-19 treatment. And there is some ongoing research looking at recombinant human angiotensin converting enzyme 2, and that is as a competitive inhibitor of viral binding to the ACE receptor. And part of this thought process comes out of the fact that the viral binding to the receptor may increase the amount of ACE receptor, which is bound, increasing the deleterious effects of this pathway from a cardiovascular standpoint, including more vasoconstriction, more fibrosis, and that blocking that activation may be clinically useful. And then separately looking at how these drugs affect the amount, the number of that receptor that is physiologically present, and how that affects progression of viral disease. So certainly a lot of work to be done looking at this pathway. Although again, at this time, we are recommending, or the cardiovascular societies recommend, continuing these therapies in people that are already on them. There is a lot of ongoing research looking at clinicaltrials.gov. There were 469 ongoing SARS-CoV-2 trials as of April 13th. That number certainly could grow over time as well. There's really a lot of trials that are, all attempting to, I think, identify the same thing, which is effective treatments for this disease state. So hopefully interesting and positive trials to come that are clinically useful. One of these trials, which I want to just highlight, is the DiSCOVERY trial. So the DiSCOVERY trial is a multi-center randomized open-label trial out of Europe with a goal recruitment of over 3,000 patients. This trial is going to have a standard of care arm and then four treatment arms, including a remdesivir arm, a lopinavir-ritonavir arm, a lopinavir-ritonavir plus interferon arm, and a hydroxychloroquine arm. So this trial, among others, certainly will hopefully generate in a timely fashion the data that we really urgently need for taking care of these very sick patients. COVID-19 in and of itself also can present as, or can appear as a comorbid cardiovascular disease. And this came from a series, a case report series that was published in Circulation. And I think it's important to identify that people who are COVID-19 positive can present with symptoms and findings that are consistent with the diagnoses of myopericarditis, of new cardiomyopathy, of acute on chronic HFrEF, and acute coronary syndrome, and that we really need to be mindful in the evaluation of these patients or in patients with really any cardiovascular disease state as to whether or not that is a due to the underlying viral illness or the viral illness is contributing or exacerbating underlying cardiovascular disease. In terms of myocarditis specifically, this data comes from a series of biopsy samples.
I didn't get that. You can also try spelling it.
And what this data is can be relatively conflicting. In one endomyocardial biopsy, there was low-grade myocardial inflammation with no viral particles that were, there was low-grade myocardial inflammation with viral particles that were seen. There's another patient that had a cardiac MRI that showed diffuse myocardial edema and no late gadolinium enhancement. That same patient had an endomyocardial biopsy that did show lymphocytic infiltrates, but no interstitial edema, with interstitial edema, but limited necrosis and no viral genome in this patient, number two. Another patient with a cardiac MRI demonstrated marked biventricular edema, diffuse late gadolinium enhancement of an entire biventricular wall. And another case from China demonstrates treatment with glucocorticoids and immunoglobulins, but again, this is just a case report. There is no definitive data for the treatment of this disease state. In terms of cardiovascular complications of COVID-19, one thing to talk about is QT prolongation. In particular, some of the therapies, notably hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin, are both QT prolonging medications and have been shown to be definitively causes of torsade de pointe. Based on a consensus report from the ACC, the American College of Cardiology, the American Heart Association, and the Heart Rhythm Society, the recommendations are to withhold QT prolonging medications if your QTC is greater than 500 at baseline, or in those with a known congenital prolongation of their QT interval, to monitor the cardiac rhythm in the QT interval while on these therapies, to withdraw the drug if the QTC exceeds 500, and to try to correct any electrolyte derangements that might contribute to QT prolongation and avoiding other QT prolonging medications. There are also a host of other drug interactions with some of the therapies that are being studied for COVID-19. One thing to identify is tocilizumab can be associated with hypertension, although it doesn't have any QTC prolonging effects. So moving on to just some other more narrow cardiovascular conditions. One is cardiac arrest and CPR. This certainly presents an area of ethical and moral dilemma, given scarce resource use. There's very little data about outcomes in this patient population, but one cohort retrospectively from China of 136 COVID-19 positive patients who underwent CPR demonstrated that there was a very high incidence of a respiratory etiology as the cause of cardiac arrest. 90% of these patients had asystole as the initial rhythm. Only 13% achieved ROSC. Only 3% survived to 90 days, survived to 30 days. And actually only 0.7%, one patient had a favorable 30-day neurological outcome. Regarding ECMO, this data comes from the ELSO registry on COVID-19 cases. At this time, there's no definitive data, but at least this prospective registry. They're acquiring data, requesting data entry in real time, is potentially clinically useful. And so as of April 13th, there were 275 confirmed cases of COVID-19 that were being treated with ECMO. The majority of this is, 92% of this is VV ECMO. The median runtime is 182 hours at the time of that this data was pulled. And among these patients, 94 of them have completed their ECMO course. Only a total of 39 patients have been discharged from the hospital. And of those, 11 were discharged alive and 28 were discharged deceased. So, you know, at least at the time of April 13th in the evening, there were only 11 patients that were reported to have survived the utilization of VV or VA ECMO. So this is certainly an area of ongoing investigation. Finally, a heart transplant patients. So one cohort of 87 orthotopic heart transplant recipients that largely came out of Hubei province in China. None of these patients experienced severe COVID-19 despite living in an endemic region. Another case report out of China of two patients who were COVID-19 positive and recipients of heart transplants only noted that both patients survived, one with a relatively milder course of illness, one with a more severe course of illness. So at this time, it's not really known, but there's some discussion and thought process that immunosuppression may impact the overall clinical outcome of this patient, of these patients, maybe potentially by decreasing that stage three, that cytokine storm phase of illness. A couple more points about transmission and how it maybe affects our cardiovascular service lines and clinical care. The virus itself is predominantly detected in lower respiratory samples, as I've talked about. It can be viable for hours in aerosolized form and days on surfaces, and people can remain positive for the virus even well after symptom resolution. So what does all this mean? It means likely the highest risk of viral transmission is during aerosolizing procedures. From a cardiovascular standpoint, that would include non-invasive positive pressure ventilation, CPR, and transesophageal echocardiography. These, as of now, have been identified as potentially high-risk procedures. And all cardiovascular practitioners who do these procedures should be mindful of that. Regarding cardiovascular procedures, more specifically, there are some recommendations from the electrophysiology societies that suggest that appropriate social distancing, telehealth, and utilizing remote device monitoring, postponing non-urgent procedures, and doing either electrical or chemical cardioversion at the bedside are potentially ways to decrease practitioner exposure to the virus. Regarding interventional cardiology, there are recommendations from China that say that emergent IV thrombolysis really should be the first form of treatment for COVID-19 positive patients presenting with ST segment elevation, myocardial infarction. In the US, the recommendations are to balance staff exposure and potential patient benefit from PCI. And one comment about that is there is increasing awareness that some patients may present or may have ST segment elevation on their ECGs, even in a pattern that is concerning for ST segment elevation, myocardial infarction, but on coronary angiography do not have significant epicardial coronary disease. And instead, this may reflect either microvascular disease or COVID-19 related myocarditis or Takotsubo stress cardiomyopathy. And so we should be mindful of all of that in the decision-making process about the use of percutaneous coronary interventions versus thrombolytics. Regarding for NSTEMIs, at least as of now, the recommendations are that until COVID-19 can be excluded, we should provide routine medical treatment and risk stratification for these patients, and that in general, we should be deferring elective structural procedures. And finally, from these same guidelines, there are, you know, at least expert opinion as to what structural interventional cardiology procedures would be considered emergent or urgent for ongoing need for intervention, even during the pandemic. And with that, I'll stop and appreciate all of your time. And I hope you found this educational and clinically useful.
Thank you, Ben. That was a terrific overview. And I think a lot have happened since the last week. And I wanted to go briefly about a few things that kind of check and balance from last week to this week. The numbers has been slowly increased in our area. So with projection to the peak in the Washington area, do you think that we already passed the peak, or we are still in front of the peak, or we are in a plateau right now?
I certainly wish I knew the answer, because it is a very important one. I think it partly depends on how you define peak. There are some people that define it as the peak as the greatest number of new patients admitted to the hospital for COVID-19. And there is another definition, which is the most number of patients who are currently in the hospital with COVID-19. And it's an important distinction, because these patients, when they're admitted, they stay in the hospital for a long time. I mean, the duration of illness in sick people can be two to three weeks. And so I think at the local level, what we're seeing is our hospital volume of COVID-19 continues to increase day by day. We may, at this point, I certainly hope we're at least during this first wave, past the peak of largest number of admissions for an individual day. And that at least is what we're seeing out of New York City, for example, where the number of admissions per day has started decreasing, and the overall hospital census is starting to decrease, but it's still really, really high. And so there's a really long tail period here as we continue to manage these patients after they've already presented. And I also say that in terms of peak, there is a lot of concern about what a second wave would look like. Some other countries that have already experienced their first wave and then liberated some of the societal stay-at-home orders have seen a second wave of disease spread and of illness, and have had to restart stay-at-home orders or shut down some of their communities and societies. And so it's certainly a dynamic process, and it's going to be a day-by-day, week-by-week, month-by-month assessment of the community burden.
Thank you. And in the past month and plus, you have been treating many patients. You've been working tireless in the intensive care unit, taking care of patients with COVID-19. And first of all, thank you for the hard work and the risk that you are taking. But can you tell me, is there any drug or therapy that anecdotally you were impressed more than the other?
I would defer to the IDSA guidelines again, which say that there is no treatment at this time for this disease. I think specifically hypothesizing, in general for viral illnesses, there have not been traditionally great success at antiviral therapies being, at least monotherapies, being effective at treatment or cure for viral infections, with a recent notable exception of Hep C, with multi-drug regimens were being effective for suppression of HIV. But in general, viral illnesses are challenging to directly treat with antiviral pharmacotherapy. And so I would be hopeful that there will, ongoing research will identify very effective antiviral therapies for this disease state. I think historically that has been challenging. There's potentially a sizable role, though, for treatments that are targeting that cytokine storm, which, at least as of now, is really hypothesized as the pathophysiologic mechanism for the development of really critical illness and multi-organ failure, ARDS, and shock. And so immunomodulating therapies, immunosuppressing therapies potentially during that stage three, if you will, of illness, I think does have a potential role. Again, also, how does that affect the host immune response? How is that going to provide durable suppression of virus? Because you do want to have your innate immune response be active to the virus, is an ongoing challenge for timing of any of these therapies as well.
That is true. Sure. And continue to see more and more studies. But again, most of them are small, anecdotal. A lot of them are published in the New England Journal of Medicine based on less than 70 patients. Do you want to comment of any new studies that caught your eyes since the last week?
The pace of literature is tremendous. I think there's, I've great admiration for all of our colleagues all over the world who are, you know, working hard in the laboratory and clinical setting to generate useful clinical research and science. You know, at this time, there's no, you know, clinically impactful new treatment trials that I've seen, although, you know, it really is a day by day. I mean, even as, you know, one day to the next can be transformative in terms of the science that's out there. Some of the things that I've seen most recently include more assessments of the coagulation effects of this virus, including studies that identify an increased thrombotic risk due to activated clotting factors in these patients. And I think thinking about the anticoagulation system in these patients is really going to be important moving forward. Although again, at this time, really nothing directly in terms of therapeutics. There's also, you know, growing data on more biomarkers, including BNP. You know, one area that I think is, you know, has been underappreciated recently that has been growing in the literature is the societal impacts of this disease, not just on the people that are positive, but on the people that are not COVID-19 positive. And there's a growing awareness that there's been a decrease in the volume of patients presenting with cardiac emergencies, including STEMIs and potentially aortic dissections. And so, you know, one of the concerns that I think we all need to have as medical professionals is that patients are not getting the appropriate and needed medical therapies for their known conditions, even regardless of COVID-19. And that's multifactorial due to patients not wanting to come into the hospital, not wanting to come in and get care, potentially delaying care, which is necessary. And, you know, trying to be very mindful about that, utilizing telehealth and ensuring that people get the appropriate interventions and treatments that they need is critically important as well.
Thank you. And maybe finally, on a personal level, it probably crosses your mind. When you're working there, you see all those patients, there is always a risk for getting infection. In fact, we have healthcare professionals or providers that did receive or they were infected by the virus. So despite the fact that you taking all the PPE precautions, what crosses your mind when you're treating those patients, and when is the next time that you would check yourself or do an assay to see if you were infected?
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly a good question. You know, I think that the first reaction I have is gratitude to all of our colleagues, all of the hospital employees, the nurses, the cafeteria workers, the environmental service workers who, you know, we're really all in it together as one team in treating this illness. You know, it is a calling to practice medicine. It is a privilege. I grateful for the opportunity and the role, but it is certainly a risk. I think that there are individuals who would be at higher risk if they acquire the virus than I am. And so from my own standpoint, I have volunteered to work more in the ICUs, and I will continue to do so as long as I can. So, but you know, we certainly need to have adequate protective equipment for all clinical workers. And, you know, I continue to hope that society at large is able to produce more and more PPE for that there's enough for everybody to stay safe.
Thank you very much, Ben, for all what you do, taking care of patients in our area, and also for bringing us really a very comprehensive overview about the disease that we're all struggling with. I hope you will stay safe and healthy, and so as the co-workers that work with you, take care of yourself, and hopefully we'll get through this soon, and we can just learn more about the science about it, all the things that are unknown as we learn together to be able to combat this disease. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.